Hi, Michel.
Oh, hi.
I have a somewhat embarrassing question. I told you I read a lot of your books, but to be honest, I never understood what you mean by discourse. Could you help?
I'd be happy to, but I'm almost sure I won't be able. The notion of discourse was enormously important to me. That's true. However, all my attempts to define this notion failed eventually. I always was explicit on this point. In The Archaeology of Knowledge, I talked about my indiscriminate use of the terms statement, event, and discourse. I also spoke about the rather fluctuating meaning of the word discourse, and I admitted that I have used and abused this word in many different senses.
But perhaps you could try. You just start with the basics and then proceed to more complex stuff.
I promise you, it won't work, but I'm ready to give it a shot. To start with, a discourse is not a discussion. So, if somewhere, like in class or at a party, on TV or on the internet, a multiplicity of opinions is confronted with one another, this is far from constituting a discourse. Certainly, informal conversations do carry along with them bits and pieces of discursive practices, but they are not right away proper discourses.
So discourse is not something like a public opinion?
Exactly. It is a much more narrow and at the same time a much more basic practice in speech and in writing that explores specific objects and topics. For example, the question concerning madness, the problem of illness, or sexuality. You could also say that discourses are tied to specific disciplines, such as, psychiatry or medicine. At least, this is what I thought in the beginning, when I did my first book on the history of madness. Don't forget that I started out as a historian of science. And very quickly, it turned out that disciplines such as psychiatry are not standing alone, but have multiple connections to other disciplines and areas. For example, biology on the one side and law on the other. In addition, they are tied to the social structure of a society, its economy, and so on and so forth, which makes all of this rather complicated.
That's what I expected.
Yes, but it's not my fault. In a sense, the term discourse answers or reacts to these complexities, to the various layers of psychiatric or medical statements and their connections and correspondences, as well as their reference to specific objects, styles, concepts and topics. So you see, this has little to do with a discussion on TV or in the news portal.
Perhaps it would further clarify things if you contrast this with Habermas's notion of discourse.
Well, our perspectives are rather different from one another. Habermas's notion of discourse as a kind of reasonable dialogue strikes me as normative. Habermas has a philosophical ideal in his mind, whereas I struggle with describing historical developments, with reconstructing what I call the actuality of the past. We could also say that when Habermas is speaking of discourse, he largely neglects my crucial interest, namely the inner commonalities between discourse and power. I am convinced that it is extremely hard to talk freely about the problems of madness and or sexuality. In my eyes, it is an illusion if you believe that you can say directly, without any distance or gap, what you think, assume or imagine.
But here we are, talking.
On this point, I also had a disagreement with Chomsky. It is much too simple to assume that there are only two things, grammar on the one side and free speech on the other. In between, there is a third entity, precisely what I call discourse. There is an established practice of speaking and writing, and that, without us taking notice, is characteristic of a specific time and a specific culture or society, determining the ways according to which we can address specific issues. This is why, in archaeology of knowledge, I often refer to the regularities or the implicit rules of discursive practices.
Okay, thanks. I think I got it. I have to confess, however, that I recall rather different things. This might be due to the fact that I mostly read Discipline and Punish, but as early as 71 you said the following, and I quote, "Discursive practices are not purely and simply ways of producing discourse. They are embodied in technical processes in institutions, in patterns for general behavior, in forms for transmission and diffusion, and in pedagogical forms which at once impose and maintain them." End of quote.
Yes, yes, I do. There, the rather fluctuating meaning of the word discourse is quite obvious. I guess, after all, this has to do with May 68, the student occupation protests, the opening up of new perspectives for societal life, and so on and so forth. Until the archaeology of knowledge, I very much held a self-contained understanding of discourse. After May 68, or rather starting with Discipline and Punish, my focus shifted and I was mostly interested in the relation between discursive and non-discursive practices, and thus eventually in the relation between discourse and power. Against this background, I introduced yet another concept that was meant to clarify things, but in fact only blur them. I mean the term dispositif. It wasn't even properly translated into English. Sometimes it is apparatus, sometimes device or construction. dispositif was also meant to express my interest in another aspect of discursive practices, namely the relation between what is and can be said in a given society and that which cannot be said. But that's a different story.
Okay, okay, I see. I don't want to insist on this. But what you just pointed out amounts to saying that if I have difficulties in understanding the meaning of the word discourse, it is because you yourself had difficulties?
In a sense, yes.
Got it. You see, this isn't a problem for me, but out there, a lot of people are upset for this reason.
Yeah, I heard about it. And I admit I wasn't clear. But how about other concepts that are crucial for the humanities? Take labor, for example, or culture, action, language. Are there clear definitions for these terms? Or let's take another example closer to home. Almost everybody knows and uses Thomas Kuhn's concepts of paradigm. Now, there was somebody who actually counted the various senses of Kuhn's use of the term. How much would you guess he found?
Perhaps 3 or 4?
21.
That's funny, but it doesn't really help.
That's true. So, how about the following? Perhaps the important, the central and foundational concepts of a theory are the ones that cannot be defined once and for all. They must remain in the vague.
This then would entail the question as to why one insists on getting a precise definition of discourse before one uses the concept or even thinks about it. Or if it wouldn't be better just to work with the concept and try it out to see what it can do or what it can't, similar to a tool where the details are also unknown.
Yeah, this would be one option. Another possibility would be to conceive of the use of discourse as a discourse in itself. That is, as an ongoing exploration of certain objects, styles, concepts, and topics, an exploration that is not quickly coming to an end. It even continues when I long turned into a puppet. In this sense, you could read again the concluding statements from Archaeology of Knowledge, where I say, and I quote, "Discourse is not life. Its time is not your time." And so on.
Which would also mean we could continue on this at our next meeting. Thank you, Michel.
You're welcome.